walk into the car park earlier, no one was here. That's been coming to me. So, thanks for coming. Tonight we're going to look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and we're going to look at Paul's letter to the Corinthian church. But as we're looking at our series, we want to see how does this apply to us, the BBC, the Zimbabwean church. What is God saying to us? What is Paul saying to us? And how does this, how's this relevant, and how do we apply it to our lives? But before we begin, I know we've already prayed, but let me just commit this time to the author of his word. Father, I just want to come to you right now and thank you for the words that you sang. Thank you for the opportunity to come before your throne and worship. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity to be able to look into your word to see what you have for us. Father, as we pause just for a brief time tonight, I pray, God, that you would still our hearts and our minds, especially mine. Father, I pray that you would speak to us in a fresh new way. If this is a passage that we're familiar with, Lord, I pray that you would just reveal something new. If it's a passage that we've heard before and we haven't applied it, Father, I pray that we would do so. That we would become obedient to your word. Not hearers only, but doers. Father, I pray that you would remove any distractions that you may have. But I pray that you would give us a holy, reverent fear of who you are as God, the creator of the universe, the one who can simply stop giving us breath each day. We thank you for your grace and your mercy in our lives to allow us to continue day to day in spite of ourselves. Thank you for the opportunity to share your word in spite of myself. So Lord, we commit this time to you with all the many things. I pray, Lord, that you would just have your way in our hearts and our lives this evening. In your prayer, in your name we pray. Amen. So Trevor contacted me and asked me to share, and he said, choose a passage where you can take 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and I thought, 2 Corinthians, we can do this. Until I read through the chapter, and then I'm like, wow, this is a tough one. But so applicable, I think, to us as a church, as a congregation. And then he asked for a title, and I am not very creative when it comes to titles. I'm not. But I started looking at 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians, and what is Paul's theme? What is he trying to communicate to the Corinthian church? And the title of my message that I've come up with is A Holy Ambition, Pleasing the Lord Through Our Call to Reconciliation. And as we dig into God's Word tonight, folks, I just want us to take time to reflect on where we are as a church, reflect on where we are individually, in our families, our workplaces, our schools, wherever we may be. And what is God calling us to do as a church, as BBC, as believers, in our mandate, our call to reconcile our lives to God, but also to bring reconciliation from others to God? How can we initiate that? What does Paul say about that? So we're going to look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, and I'm just going to kind of briefly catch us up to what is he talking about, because there's some parallels with 1 Corinthians as well. So Paul is our author, obviously, because that's our theme, Paul's letters to the church. So he is our author. Paul's writing in Macedonia whilst on his way to to another visit to the church in Corinth. Our background is the church started in AD 52 on his second missionary journey. And this is the first time that God has actually allowed Paul to stay longer, or as long as he wished to stay. So Paul stayed in Corinth for about 1.5 years. The second letter of Paul to the Corinthian church was occasioned by the report brought from Titus I'm telling Paul that his first letter to the Corinthian church, his letter of rebuke, was received and duly noted. And the purpose of this epistle, Titus' report was encouraging to Paul, but there was evidently there were still some issues within the church that Paul needed to address. One of those issues was false apostles within the church discrediting Paul's authority of apostleship. And that's one reason this book was written. We'll see that. We had a problem with some of the Judaizers. The Judaizers were the teachers who gave the gospel and then added on to it. In other words, they would add to it and say, you have to do A, B, and C, but you also have to follow the Mosaic law and go into circumcision. So we've got the Judaizer teachers who seem to follow Paul, but were undermining his authority as the apostle and undermining his teaching. They questioned his confidence in truth. They questioned his speaking ability, his unwillingness to accept support from the church in Corinth in chapter 11. And some people had not reported, that they were still living an immoral life. See, his first letter in 1 Corinthians was a letter of rebuke to the church because it was a sinful lifestyle. What had happened is they had embraced sexual idolatry, immorality, and a multitude of different sins within the church. So he writes this letter. Now here we are in Macedonia. He gets report back from Titus and says that the letter was received and it was handled well. However, there's still some problems. There's still some issues. There's some guys who are trying to discredit you as the apostle and your leadership. And there's also some folks still dabbling in an immoral lifestyle. The primary purpose of this book, I believe, is for Paul to vindicate his position as apostle. And as he does this, he describes his ministry in a few different ways. In chapter 2, I'm not going to go through every passage here, but just catching us up to chapter 5. In chapter 2, he describes his ministry as being triumphant. He describes it as being accredited in chapter 3. Glorious. Honest. A time of suffering. We all know that Paul had a time of suffering. And in chapter 5, he brings us up to speed and he says his ministry was hopeful. We're going to look at the first 10 verses of chapter 5, and he focuses on his time in the presence of God, his creator. What does that look like? What does it mean to have my body glorified, a glorified body in the presence of a holy Savior? He describes his ministry as being devoted, a devout believer to the following of Jesus Christ, the Christ who died for all, therefore all have died, and he has reconciled us to himself. And in the last part, of this chapter, Paul focuses on that reconciliation through Jesus Christ. I'm going to kind of read through this as we walk through it, rather than just reading it all in one block, because it's kind of long. Let's look at the first four verses. For we know that if the earthly tent, which is our house, is torn down, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Now let's just stop right there. In the Gospel of Mark, we also hear Jesus' word saying, with your hands you tear this temple down, in 3 days I'll rebuild it with no hands. Okay? So we see this parallel right here. We know that if this earthly tent, which is our house, is torn down, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Verse 2. For indeed in the house we groan, longing to be clothed with our dwelling from heaven. Inasmuch as we, having put it on, will not be found naked. Verse 4. For indeed while we are in this tent, we groan, being burdened, because we do not want to be unclothed, but to be clothed, so that what is mortal will be swallowed up by life. What in the world is this saying to us? All right, so he's talking about this tent, this body, this physical body. When we go, when we die, when we keel over, however you want to phrase it, when we pass, we're dead. That's the point. As a believer, we stand before God. But there's some question here, because as we look at this, the ancient writers sometimes portrayed the present or the resurrected body as being clothed, and death is being disrobed. Now, in the culture of the Judeans and other Eastern people, they loathed nudity. That was a disgrace. And when you get to the Greeks and the Romans, they disliked it in particular situations. I don't know what those situations are, so we're not going to go there. But the theologians, there's a debate as to when do you receive this glorified body? Because the Corinthian Christians are saying, well, when we die, we want to be clothed in righteousness. When do we get this glorified body? Okay, now I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this, but some of the different thoughts are is when you die, You have a disembodied spirit. So your spirit goes to be with Jesus, and upon Christ's return of his church, you then get your glorified body. Another thought is that you receive a temporary body until Christ returns, and then you get your glorified body. And then, of course, the third response or thought is when you die, you immediately get your glorified body. And I'm not sure if Scripture is really clear on that. I've looked and looked and looked, and I haven't seen anything. Believers, we do know that when believers pass on, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. We are with Jesus. As to what state we're in, not sure. But when you look at the next verse, verse 5, he says, "Now he who prepared us for this very purpose is God, who gave us his Spirit as a pledge." So we're not going to focus on when you get your glorified body. You're going to get it. But God says, or Paul says, here's the pledge, here's the seal, here's the security. You're a believer, you're adopted into the body of Christ, and the Holy Spirit seals you for that day. You will receive your new body at some point in time, whenever that may be. So I was going to make a bald joke, but I won't go there. So some guys that struggle to grow their hair back, at some point in your time with Jesus, you're going to have a full head of hair. You're going to have a glorified body, man. This is awesome. So anyway, so Paul says, I'm giving your spirit as a pledge, as a testimony that you are going to be glorified and you will be as Jesus is. You're going to stand before your Creator. And let's look at verses 5 through 8. I've lost my place. So we read 5. Now he who prepared us for this very purpose is God, who gave to us his spirit as a pledge. Therefore, in verse 6, being always of good courage, and knowing that while we are home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. This is the Lord's deal. Whenever we get our body, that's his problem. Verse 8. We are of good courage, I say, and I prefer rather to be absent from the body and to be at home with the Lord. In verse 9, therefore we also have as our ambition, whether at home or absent, to be pleasing to him. Paul says, this is our ambition, whether absent or at home. That's not the issue. The issue is, I want to please my Savior. I want to please Jesus. That's my ambition. And it's a part of my title, a holy ambition, to live out our calling of reconciliation. And we're going to see this. Paul has already started that reconciliation by addressing the Corinthian church and 1 Corinthians. And now he's vindicating his apostleship in his second letter. It's an ambition, whether absent or at home, is to please Jesus. And in verse 10, he says, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may be recompensed for his deeds in the body, according to what he has done, whether good or bad. This judgment seat of Christ, the bema seat of Christ, we will receive what is due to us, whether good or bad. Now, this judgment is not for unbelievers. Folks, this is for the church. This is for us. This is for believers. It's not to determine salvation. That was done at the cross, and that was done when we embraced Jesus as our Lord. This now is a judgment or reward system based on how faithfully we served Christ. And when you look at verse 10, at the beginning it says, for we must all appear. The Greek word to appear is more than just to stand or to show up at an event. It's to reveal. It's to expose. Now, this is a reward ceremony. I'm going to call it a ceremony. But it's a judgment where we are rewarded for the things that we have done for God. But we will have to answer for our sins. Okay? So we're secured in our faith. We're here before Jesus. And he's going to reward us for the children's church on Sunday and what a phenomenal job they did this morning. He's going to reward us for taking food to the hungry. We're going to be rewarded for our obedience and following Christ's mandate in Matthew to go and make disciples. We're going to be rewarded for caring for the widows, the orphans, and the poor. You're going to be rewarded for reflecting Christ in your thoughts, your speech, and your actions. But we're going to have to answer for the gossip that we spread around. We're going to have to answer
for those times where we've come to church and we've raised our hands and we've prayed and we've praised and we go home and that night we wallow in sin and we're looking at things on a computer we shouldn't look at. We're going to have to answer for our testimony around unbelievers and how we've blown that testimony or how we've maybe raised God up for others to see. This is the judgment seat. It's for believers, not for unbelievers. And when he says, for we must all appear, all of us, not some, all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may be recompensed for his deeds in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. And verse 11, therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade men, but we are made manifest to God, and I hope that we are made manifest also in your consciences. Now, in this writing, we're going to see some of the things that motivate Paul in his ministry. And one of the things that motivates him is this right here, the fear of the Lord. And I wonder, in our church today, do we have an accurate understanding of what it means to fear the Lord? A holy reverence of God. Knowing that we live sometimes in sin, and we come to church and we pretend that it's not there, or we cover it up, because no one's really going to find out, right? Where Paul's telling us that we're going to hold account to our behavior. And one of the things that motivates Paul is the fear, a holy respect of God, the creator of the universe, a God who says the world is like my footstool, a God who says I hold everything in the palm of my hand, a God that says I'm sending my son Jesus as a sacrificial lamb to go to the cross because of your sin, so that you can have eternal life with me. A God that has created everything. Paul's motivation, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade men to get their life together, to reconcile themselves to God, to live for Christ. Verse 12, we are not again commending ourselves to you, but are giving you an occasion or an opportunity to be proud of us, so that you will have an answer for those who take pride in appearance and not in heart. Here he is. He's addressing the heart issue of the church. Because what we had are false apostles who were taking pride and glory in their appearance, what they look like. And we see this in the Pharisees in Jesus' times, where they would have the phylacteries on their forehead, and they would walk around and gloat because it was image, it was perception. This is what we do. And Paul right now is addressing the heart. You know, when someone applies for a job, what do? We hand in the CV?
Is that God saying, Steve? No. You know, for a job, we hand in our CV, and we have to have commendation. We have to have referrals. Someone to say or to back up or validate who we are, and that we, whether or not we qualify for that job. Is it okay if I just continue?
Yeah.
Can you guys hear me? It's a good thing I had this iPad earlier. So these guys are boasting about various preachers, and they're putting people on a pedestal, and it's about appearance. And Paul is saying, now it's about the heart. I can't read my scriptures now. Give me a second, folks. Right. Where am I? Verse 12. Yeah, thank you. So Paul's saying we're not bringing commendation. We're not having to validate who we are. We've already done that. We're not, again, commending ourselves to you, but we're giving you an occasion or an opportunity to be proud of us, so that you will have an answer for those who take pride in appearance and not in heart. Verse 14, let's get to 14. For the love of Christ controls us. Now let's go back to 13. For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. If we are of sound mind, it is for you. It's thought that some of the Christians in the Corinthian church were accusing Paul and some of his followers of just being crazy, being mad, being nuts. So he's saying,
that's going to be funny. That's what I'm talking about.
beside ourselves, it is for God. If we are of sound mind, it is for you. And in verse 14, for the love of Christ controls us. So he confirms it's the love of Christ who's compelling us. It's the love of Christ who is controlling us. In other words, we're not crazy. We're not mad. I'm going crazy. We're not crazy. We're not mad. It's the love of Christ that compels us and motivates us to continue on in our ministry. Verse 14. For the love of Christ controls us, having concluded this, that one died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, so that they who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who died and rose again on their behalf. So we see another motivation in Paul's ministry is the motivation of Christ's love. Not Paul's love for Christ, but Christ's love for him. Now, think about Paul's history. Where did he come from? Paul used to be Saul, right? He killed Christians in the name of God, thinking that he was doing the right thing. He meets Jesus on the road to Damascus, and Jesus transforms Paul, or Saul at the time, radically by removing a heart of stone and giving a heart of flesh. So Paul is motivated by the love of Christ. He understands and he fears God because he knows that God himself, in the form of Jesus Christ, met him on the road to Damascus and said, Paul, make a new plan. That's paraphrased. All right? And he pulls Paul into himself. He reconciles Paul to himself on the road to Damascus. Verse 16, therefore, from now on, we recognize no one according to the flesh. Even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him in this way no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creature. The old things have passed away. Behold, new things have come. Our knowledge of men can no longer be based on exterior performance or appearance. When we look at Galatians 5, we're told that we're going to know somebody by the fruit or the evidence that they produce, right? We will understand that someone is a believer because of the way they live, because of the way they speak, because of the way they respond. That's how we will identify another believer. And so our knowledge of men can no longer be based on their outer lives. A man, when he comes to Christ, or woman, comes to Christ, that person is altogether changed. So if someone claims to be a believer and that life doesn't back up what their claim is, we need to think, is that person a believer? Because we're told in Scripture, the old way of life is gone. It's no longer us who lives, but it's Christ who lives through us. So as a believer, things have changed. Everything has become fresh. Everything has become new. This is all God's doing as he's reconciled us to himself. And he gave us the ministry of reconciliation. When we finish up verse 16, it says, therefore, from now on, we recognize no one according to the flesh. Even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know him in this way no longer. Verse 17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Now, all these things are from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Namely, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them. And he has committed to us the word of reconciliation. So when we look at verse 17, here's another motivator behind Paul's ministry. Is that we are a new creature. We're a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. There's a new way of thinking. We are now thinking through the eyes or the lens of our Creator, of Jesus Christ. There's a new way of ministry, a new way of working with our hands. We are now feeding people. We are caring for the poor. We are caring for the homeless. Maybe there's a point where we're kneeling down humbly before someone and we're washing their feet. As a believer, we use our hands to glorify God. There's a new home. We're aliens. We don't belong here. Our citizenship is in heaven. We have a new residence, and we have a new heart. And God says when a repentant sinner comes to him and embraces Jesus and all that he has, all that his becomes ours, and he removes the heart of stone and he gives a heart of flesh, when that happens, folks, there is a life that is transformed. There is a life that is hungry after the things of Jesus And this is a motivation for Paul to continue in his ministry. He knew that very well. He used to kill Christians. Right? And now he's a new creation. That lifestyle is completely gone. Now we're seeing a man who had authority, who had power, who's now been beaten, shipwrecked, and we know all the stories. A man of humility. Verse 18. Now all these things are from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Verse 19, namely that God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against him, and he has committed to us the word of reconciliation. We have been given the word, we have been given the responsibility of reconciliation. But how often do we hold other people's sins or trespasses against them? How often are we too busy trying to get the speck out of somebody else's eye while we have the plank in our own? And Paul is saying, you have been given the role of reconciliation. When we look at, when you go back to Romans chapter 9, and 9 through 11, I think it is, you look at Paul's heart. He gives us a glimpse into his heart. And in I think it's chapter 9, where he's talking about his fellow Jews, and he says, I would be willing to be separated from Christ, and accursed, separated from Christ, for the sake of these brethren coming to know Jesus. Now, Paul knew very well that cannot happen, but it gives us a glimpse of his heart. He was so motivated by love, the love of Christ. He was so motivated by the fear of God. He was so motivated by this call of reconciliation that he makes the comment, I would be willing to be separated from Christ for the sake of this one coming to know him. Do we have that burden for the lost? Or do we harbor bitterness? Do we harbor anger and resentment? Do we hold others' trespasses and issues and problems against them? It's a letter to the church. It's a letter to us. And Paul's saying, you, because Christ has reconciled you to the Father, you now have been given the word of reconciliation. It is your role, your job. And that's a part of the Great Commission. This is the gospel. Going and making disciples. And how do we do that? We introduce people to Jesus. We introduce people to the Messiah. We introduce people to the Lamb who went to the cross for us. Reconciled. Broken to the Father. In verse 20, therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were making an appeal through us. We beg you, on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. We are ambassadors. There's another motivation for Paul. You're an ambassador. You're like a diplomat. You've got a huge responsibility. What does an ambassador do? It's a representative or a messenger of another country into a foreign area, a foreign land. And we are ambassadors of Jesus Christ. Remember, this is not our home. Our citizenship is in heaven. And Paul's saying, you are ambassadors. You are messengers. You are the ones to represent Jesus and his kingdom. And we better do it well. And he's saying, as ambassadors, you are to go and to reconcile relationship, bridge relationship between you and yourself, church families, people, and God. You are ambassadors for Jesus Christ. And in closing, in verse 21, and this is the gospel, and this is the motivation of Paul. This is his heart. He made him who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf, so that we might become the righteousness of God. None of us in this room deserve God's favor, his grace, his mercy, his forgiveness. None of us. None of us in this room have earned the right to be reconciled to the living God. None of us. And yet God is saying, through Paul, he who made him, who knew no sin, to be sin on our behalf, so that we might become the righteousness of God. Through the death, the burial, and the resurrection of the sinless Jesus, we can be made clean. We can be made pure. We can be made holy clothe yourselves with gentleness and patience and kindness. And he goes through the small list of things that we are to clothe ourselves so that we can minister to other people and to the lost. But then he finally says, above all this, put on love, which is the perfect bond of unity. And when we have a right perspective of who God is, and we fear who God is, reverently, and we understand that it's God who has reconciled us to himself, and he's given us the commission to reconcile others to himself, to take the gospel to the lost. And we see this right here, that he who knew no sin became sin on our behalf. Wow, folks, that should motivate us to do a few different things in our lives. It should motivate us as believers first, as we looked at this morning at communion. We have an opportunity to take this week to do an inventory of our lives. It's an opportunity for us to look inside and see and ask, do I really fear God? Do I really understand what it means to fear him? Do I really understand what Christ's love means and its implications in my life? Am I motivated in my ministry, in my life, in my family, in my workplace by reconciliation? Is that really my role? Do I understand that I'm an ambassador of Jesus? Am I following Christ's command? Am I obedient to his word in its entirety? Am I putting on love, that perfect bond of unity? Questions that we need to ask, folks, that I'm asking myself daily. And sadly, I fall short all the time. And I look at Paul's letter, and I look at chapter 5 especially, but in conjunction with 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians. And I think, man, I've got a lot of work to do. Because I've never looked at my role as a believer as being one to carry the word of reconciliation. And we need to be mindful of that. There's a lot of broken people. There's a lot of people without Christ. There's a lot of people who think they're with Christ, and they're not. And our role as ambassadors, as believers, is to be one to take reconciliation to the Savior. Bearing in mind that one day, every one of us who know Jesus will stand before the judgment seat of Christ and give account of our behavior and our obedience, our lack of obedience to God's call. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this evening. Thank you for your word, Lord. I'm wrestling through this passage, and I hope, Lord, that what was communicated tonight was clear. Father, I pray that we'll be able to take 2 Corinthians 5, and that we can just chew on this through the week, and we can apply it to our lives. That, Lord, we can ask some of these questions, and we'll maybe by next Sunday be able to answer some of them, maybe one, maybe not. But Lord, I pray that we would wrestle with these things. Lord, I pray that you would give us a holy ambition, a desire, and a joy